Today on the podcast, I've got a Boise State basketball legend joining me. We're going to learn about his college days, his pro days, and even now his days as a coach for a youth basketball club. You do not want to miss this episode of The Game Time Guru. So,
what time is it?
Game time, boo!
What's going on, everybody? Welcome out to another episode of The Game Time Guru. Now, this is a very special episode of The Game Time Guru because while I love all the guests that have been on my show in the past, it's not every day that you get to interview your childhood idol. Now, I legitimately mean that. This guy that's on my show today was the reason that I changed my shot in basketball. I used to shoot two-handed. Because I watched this guy, I started shooting just like him because I wanted to be like this guy. When people ask me, who was your favorite player? I'm a Jazz fan. Back in the late 90s, people thought that I was going to say Karl Malone. I never said Karl Malone. I used my guest's name as my favorite player. So I'm legitimately excited to have him on the show with me today. And in Boise State basketball history, before there was Booker Neighbors, Kobe Carl, Matt Bauscher, Derek Marks, Chandler Hutchison, and other greats that have been in the last 20 years, there was this team in the late 90s at Boise State University, led by this guy. And you got chills every time you'd hear the starting lineups. You got used to hearing it every single time. People waited for it. That 6'6 senior from Tacoma, Washington, number 20, Roberto Bergerson. And that is who is joining me on the show today. Berto, thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to join me on the show.
I appreciate it. That's big time stuff, man. I really appreciate that. You gave me chills, honestly. Just, you know, with that, you know, just the way you spoke about me and the effect that I had on you and stuff, and it almost kind of brings me a little bit to some emotions a little bit, just because it's you know, you forget, you know where you've been, and it just makes people feel good to know that they were appreciated. You had little guys like yourself when you were young, looking up and the impact you have, and sometimes you forget about the impact that you do have. And so I really appreciate it, man. That's a big deal. That's a big thing.
Well, yeah, I appreciate you, man, more than you even know. So, like, it's crazy because I was in fourth grade, and they didn't know Boise State basketball, because back then, like, they didn't play Boise State basketball games on TV a lot. Like, the only way you get to go see them is actually at the game. And my uncle was a huge Boise State fan, and he took me to all the games like that he possibly could. So, like, I'd save all the newspaper articles, I'd save everything, and I just went through them last night. I'm 29 years old now, and I pulled out these newspaper articles last night. I legitimately have a couple pulled up right now, which we're going to get to in a second because they're memories, but, like, I've got one of you throwing down an alley-oop against Utah State. G-Dub threw you an oop, and I got another one with the Washington game, so we'll get to that in a second. I also would like to state real quick that I actually got to interview you in the fourth grade. Your wife was actually working with my mom at the time, and I got to interview you, and you actually sent me a few things. You got me a full roster picture and it said "Shoot for the Stars," and then you signed it. And then you got me I still got it right here, this Big West basketball program from a game, and it's got you on the front cover, and you signed it, Roberto Bergerson, number 20, and I got it right here. So anyways, it's like 20 years later, I'm still like the big, like, the fan, like, I'm your biggest fan. So it's crazy, man. So yeah, I greatly appreciate it. It's an honor to have you on here. And I want to start in your college days when you first stamped your legacy in the Treasure Valley. Now, I know that there's, like, a lot of memories in college, but I want to know, like, in those 2 years, it was kind of a young team. Like, those teams were kind of young, especially your second year, like your last year with Boise State, like the 98-99, I believe it was. It is mainly a lot of youngins, except for a few of you that were leading the team. And I wanted to know what your favorite part was about being on those teams.
Well, I mean, my favorite part, I mean, I guess to start with, to be honest with you, my favorite part about just being, you know, at Boise State, being a Bronco and being in Boise was absolutely the community. And, you know, just the way that I was embraced, you know, I was at a time in my life that I was very, very immature, you know, really, really, really up and down. Just kind of had, like I said, bipolar just going on in my life, and I didn't have a whole lot of a lot of structure. And you know, when my high school coach Ed Boyce was the assistant at Boise State. He's the one that convinced me and brought me there. I really didn't have a lot, so he was kind of saying to me, but he just kind of told me, you know, you're gonna love this community. The community's gonna love you. I won't forget the day that he talked to me and said, you're going to have a major impact in this community, and it's going to do the same to you. And I hope that I was able to reciprocate what the community did for me. But the best part of being a Bronco was just, I mean, that community helped to save my life, really. So, I mean, that's what I remember most about Boise. As far as being on the team, it was the God. It was the brothership, the brotherhood that I created. And to this day, you know, just thinking back to the guys that helped me out when I first got there. He wasn't a player, but he was a coach, and he was a past player, former player, Shambrick Williams and Joe Wyatt, and JD Lean. And then to this day, my best friend in the world is Jerry Washington, Justin Lyons, and Keewon Woods. Those guys, I still see Abe, still see Booker, ran into Rich Morgan a couple of months ago. Those guys, Clint Hordeman, those guys just creating that bond and having that, creating brothers. CJ Williams, I still talk to him every week. It's just, you can't trade that stuff in, and that experience that you create and you have and you create with them, you know, last with you for so long, and it was such an enjoyable experience with you. Obviously the relationship I had with community and the relationship I had with my brothers was the best thing that ever, you know, the best part of being a Bronco.
Man, you bring up those names, like you just name dropped a couple of guys that just, like, it rings in my head. Like, as much as I love Boise State, I graduated from there. I go to tons of games. They've seen so much success, like, in the last, you know, probably the last 10 years or so. They've got those, you know, a couple seasons where they were really great. It's just crazy because for some reason I just always remember those days, because it was you, it was G-Dub, it was Keewon. Abe was really young, but still we knew he could shoot, because when he got in the game he could actually shoot when he was young. So then he proved himself later on in his career. Man, it's just crazy that you name dropped all of them. Now I'm like, going through memory lane again. And speaking of your players, man, I know, like, you and Jerry Washington, you pretty much led the team. You guys were the leaders on the squad, but you named a lot of guys. I want to know, I mean, I know you loved all of them, but if you were to play pickup ball and needed just one player, and you guys were all in your prime, from that squad, who would you take?
Oh, from that team? Man, that's a tough one. From that, you know what? If from that team, it would have been Jerry. It would have been Jerry. Jerry was absolutely, I have to be honest with you, man. This is tough right now to even talk about this stuff. But just because it's Jerry and everything that happened to him. But Jerry was the ultimate competitor. After Jerry got sick, I changed my number from 20 to 11. And the reason why I did it was because I wanted to honor him. And I basically had a point in my career where I changed the way that I felt like I needed to play. And I started to play in a way where I just played with reckless abandon, because that's the way he played. I always thought that I played hard until I played with Jerry. And he was the type of dude that it didn't matter whether it was practice, games, or open gym, he was diving on the floor for balls. He was defending guys like no other. I mean, he would foul you. He would do whatever it took to win, and he would give, I mean, every ounce of effort that he had. And I never, ever, ever met anybody that played as hard as he did. And then on top of that, he was absolutely a killer. I mean, we used to tease Jerry a lot about, hey, why don't you play like this in real games? Because, I mean, in open gym, hands down, like, no one could absolutely stop him. I mean, he was unstoppable, and it was ridiculous. And then we get to the games, and he wouldn't do the same thing. But it was different. I mean, it was the role that he took on. And he would tell you, well, in the games, you know, this is the role that I play. I don't, you know, we're all on the same team. So if I have Berto on my team or Keywon on my team, I'm going to be a facilitator. But if I'm in open gym and I don't have those guys on my team and I have to do this, I'm going to do that. So I would have to say that would be a tough one. I have to pick Jerry. And I think a close second to Jerry, he wasn't actually on my team, but he came a little bit after me. But I played so much with him that he would be a close second to Jerry, and that's Jason Ellis. And he is by far probably, you know, one of the top five guys that I've ever played with, played alongside with in my career. And I only got to play with him in a regular season just 1 year. Two years, actually. We played with the Stampede together. 1 year we won a championship. The other year, you know, we did really well. But those would be the two guys that I would pick. If I could have those two guys on my team, I think I don't care who you are. I'd match up against anybody.
I love it, man. I love it. Again, Jason Ellis, another name drop, man. So that's awesome. Ah, it's crazy, like, hearing those names and seeing, like, the chemistry you had, especially with Jerry, obviously, because, like, that's when I got to see you play quite a bit when you know, you guys were in college. It was just unreal. And like I said, I have the newspaper here. One of the games, it just says, Roberto Bergeson completes a spectacular dunk off an alley-oop pass from teammate Jerry Washington on Thursday night. You guys had this chemistry, man, and it was just unreal to watch it on the court. So, yeah, that's awesome. I want to talk about something here to talk about the atmosphere. If you remember the crowd during those times, I mean, from my perspective, I was a little kid, so maybe it was just blown out of proportion. But I thought back then the Pavilion, which is now the Taco Bell Arena, I felt like that place got packed almost every single night that you guys played. I thought it was like just sold out or close to it almost every single game during those times. But maybe it was just me being little and I thought there was a lot of people there. But what was your thoughts on the atmosphere at the Boise State Pavilion back then?
It was absolutely incredible. It was absolutely incredible. I mean, to this day, I played in some amazing places. You know, I mean, I got to play at Madison Square Garden and Staples Center when it's packed, and McHale, or, you know, it's not called McHale anymore, Arizona, which is an amazing place to play, and played in Europe. And in Europe, the fans in Europe are a whole different level of passion than our fans are. But saying that, I've never experienced the energy in any of those places like I did at what I still call the Pavilion.
Right.
And so you didn't, I mean, you're not wrong at all. I mean, and it was, I mean, to kind of sum it up, I mean, I remember my first year at Boise State, and my sophomore year, and we're getting ready to go to a game, and we actually, it snowed really, really bad, and we got through a shoot around, it wasn't bad, and then we went home for shoot around and hung out a little bit and took our naps and everything else. And it was absolutely packed. We were snowed in. And Justin Lyons and I kind of were hanging out. And he was gonna be my driver to the game. And he had a little front wheel drive Mustang 5.0, and we couldn't move it. Like, we could not move it. So we called, you know, our vet up, and we called Mike Tolman, who obviously was a little bit older than us. Called him up and like, Mike, can you come get us? And I called Mike, and I said, Mike, are they going to cancel the game? And he goes, are you kidding me? And I'm like, well, we can't even move anywhere. Like, how is anybody going to be at this game? And I can't remember exactly who it was. I believe it might have been Idaho State. It wasn't like, you know, I mean, it wasn't Idaho. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't playing Washington, a top 10 team in the nation, anything like that. And so I'm thinking, there's not going to be nobody here at this game. And I mean, it was one of those snows where it was a big time snow. It was like one of the, you know, biggest at the time. And we get to the game, and I mean, it is literally packed. I mean, it is packed house in there. I mean, and it was crazy. It was crazy. And that was my like first experience and basically saying, oh my goodness, this is going to be, you know, and the game experience is going to be phenomenal. It's going to be exciting. And it was jacked up. And so that one right there just kind of summed it up for me. And then, you know, the rest of our career, I mean, yeah, we did. We had packed houses. I mean, it didn't matter who came in there. I mean, it could have been Cal Poly, who was, you know, last place in the Big West, and they were in there to watch us play the whole time. So, I can't say enough about the fans and the fan support and the community support that for the Broncos while I was there.
Man, see, that's how I thought it was, so I'm glad that it wasn't just me. It's also from a player's perspective because, yeah, I was little, so I thought it was – maybe I thought it was bigger than it was. But, no, I remember that place getting loud. People were screaming the whole entire time. I mean, we'd get on the other players. My uncle would always – he'd get seats that were, like, near the opposing bench, and we were behind the backboard, so he could just scream. He was about 22, 23 at the time, but he'd just be screaming – at the other players, and I just remember, like, I loved it, just heckling the other guys and just getting into it. It was so much fun. Do you have a favorite game that you played in college?
Oh my goodness, that's tough. Because I probably have a couple. I don't know if I can say a favorite. The UW game was obviously a special game. You know, playing so well and playing against my former team, and they were top 10 in the nation, so that was a great game. That was huge. But I think back on my favorite game, it probably wasn't even at Boise State. It was at Cal Fullerton. We were playing at Cal Fullerton, and I was a sophomore. And I hit a game winner. I kind of feel like it was the shot and it was the game. We won the game. I feel like it was the game that kind of propelled my career to where it went at Boise State. I think if it wasn't for that shot or that game, I think I still would have been good, but I don't know. It was just one of those things that kind of gave me a shot in the arm and gave me some confidence that just kind of took me to, another level. So I remember that game. Like I said, I obviously remember the UW game. I'll definitely remember I don't know if anybody people remember, but I had two senior nights. And, my first senior night was with Steve Shepard, and that was my roommate when I first got there. I'll never forget that game. I'll never forget, having that last experience with him. And then, obviously, my second senior night with D-Dub was I'll never forget that game. I'll never forget that night ever. It was an incredible experience. So those are probably the games I remember the most.
Oh, that's awesome. And speaking of your two senior nights, I was at the first one and the second one. I remember the first one I was sitting in the balcony because it got packed in there, man. We had to get seats up in the balcony, man. So, and we were all like, I hope we can get one more year of eligibility. Like everybody was just, we were hoping and it worked out. So that's rad. In regards to the UW game, just real quick, man, I don't know if I've been to a Boise State basketball game that was – I don't know. I mean, obviously, they were a great team. Top 10, top 15, can't remember exactly. But they were a really good team. And it's all obviously your former school. And, man, what I remember from that game was y'all being down 20-4. And I remember we were getting rocked. And I was sitting there with my dad and my uncle. And I had a keychain I used to always just hold in my hand. It was like my lucky charm. I was superstitious when I was in fourth grade. But anyways, I'm sitting there with a keychain. And you're down 20-4. You go on a 17-0 run, and Clint Hordeman hits a three from the corner. It's like to top it off, and you go up 21-20. And then from there, it was just like everyone started clicking. And I remember you just going crazy, and then you got a standing ovation when you went off the court. We ended up winning. It was one of the coolest experiences I've been a part of. And I remember where I was sitting, what happened that game. It was just insane. That game was just nuts, man. And I think like all of us in Boise that were at those games and were following Boise State basketball, we knew that you had the national spotlight there. Like we knew what you could do. But it was weird because it seemed like it took a lot for the nation to kind of get behind that. And then all of a sudden there's this Sports Illustrated situation that's going on. Sports Illustrated decides, they catch wind of like, oh, okay. Yeah. Like this Roberto Bergeson guy, he's pretty good. He's got to be pretty good. He took down Washington earlier in the season. Like, man, like, we should go check them out. And they were going to publish an article about you. What was it like, that whole experience from like maybe the nerves or anything, and then getting into the magazine and actually having an article written about you?
Well, I mean, it really was. I mean, it was kind of a dream come true. I mean, it was kind of like no way. Like, I mean, I grew up reading Sports Illustrated. I mean, I grew up, trying to do book reports on Sports Illustrated articles, and the teachers would tell me, no, you can't, because, I mean, that's all I read, I mean, that's all I wanted to read, all I wanted to know about. And so when they said they were coming out, because they actually came out, the game they came out to was the Utah State game, And they came out and took pictures and did all that stuff and interviewed at that game. And that game I didn't play very well. I remember they played a boxing one against me, and we were on a roll. I mean, we were on a high, and they, you know, Stu Moore was a great coach, man. He always, he was kind of like the Belichick of the Big West. He would always figure out a way to take away, you know, your best thing and make you do something different. And so, when they came in, it was surreal. It was a surreal moment. And I really, to this day, I mean, that's one of the things I wish I could go back. I wish there's so many things I would have did different in that game. So we could have won that game. It almost would have been a fairy tale type deal. But, you know, it was surreal, the experience. And then when that article came out and, you know, every people were passing it around and my family wanted 50 copies and everybody. And,
right.
You know, even to this day, I have people that bring it to me. And I still, it's hard for me to believe. That I was actually in a Sports Illustrated magazine. I mean, and not just, okay, just a little blurb. I mean, I was in there. I mean, it was a picture and everything. I mean, it's a cool thing. It's a cool thing when it's something that, you know, it's one of those things that you're proud of, and not because you're in the magazine and not because they're from all of it. Just you're proud of you were accomplished enough that people would recognize you. You know, the kids this day won't recognize it because there's so much, you know, self-promotion and so much promoting on Twitter and all that. But to have yourself and have your name, number one, in a newspaper, but two, in a national magazine, that's just, it's a lot bigger than that.
It was so cool. I remember that Utah State game. In fact, that's the article I have right here too. The Utah State game. I was there, and it was crazy. I mean, we could tell there were some nerds, and they were locking down on you on purpose. They knew what was going on at that game and stuff. So, but it was still awesome to see that Sports Illustrated article. I remember when my uncle actually got it. He had his whole, you know, year subscription. He had Sports Illustrated stacked to the ceiling in his closet. And I remember when he had that, man, like, it was legit. Because if you really think about it, even the pros, like if you're a professional basketball player, even in the NBA, but you're riding the bench your whole career, you might make a decent living, but you might not even get into a magazine like that or whatnot, you know? So it's kind of cool to see that some guy from Boise was able to get a whole entire article written about him. And yeah, your picture was in there, man. So that stamps it. So you got on the national spotlight. Obviously, the NBA was looking at you. Let's get to the night of the NBA draft. Yeah, it was like, I remember sitting there watching on the TV, like my eyes were glued. Everybody was watching it here in the Valley, I'm pretty sure. And I want you to walk us through your experience on draft night.
Wow. You know, that's another moment. I mean, you know, I don't know. A couple of moments in my life that even, you know, get, you know, are at the same level or even exceed that moment. But I mean, it was a roller coaster. I went back home to Tacoma to my grandparents' house where I was raised, where I first, you know, ever had a dream of, you know, being like Dr. J or whatever it was. And lots of family and lots of friends were there. You know, going into the draft, you know, the word that my agents were getting was that, you know, there was a good chance that I was going to be chosen in the first round by either Utah or Vancouver. Which was great because they were both great fits. You know, for me, Vancouver was obviously close. Utah was close. They both, you know, played a style that, you know, was had a little bit more structure with it. And, you know, lots of screens, light shooters, but also had an old school feel to them where, you know, they valued, you know, team defense and, you know, obviously coming from Coach J's system, that's, you know, something that, you know, was favoring. So, we thought that was going to happen and, you know, we were there and hanging out and having a good time. And I was, I mean, I was a nervous wreck. I mean, I was a nervous wreck. Up until that day, you know, I hadn't taken a day off of basketball since I think my junior year in high school. I mean, literally, I hadn't taken a day off. And that day I told myself, okay, I'm going to relax and take that day off. I mean, I was up at 5 a.m. and I couldn't sleep and I couldn't think. And so the only thing that I've been able to do my whole life when I'm stressed or not feeling good is go to the gym. So I went to the Y that I grew up at that morning, downtown Y in Tacoma, and went and just shot and shot and shot and shot until I could kind of try to get my mind off it. Didn't work very well. But like I said, I had my family there and we were all just hanging out. And I can remember this to this day. I had three phones. I had my grandparents' landline. I had my cell phone, and I must have been my wife's cell phone, just because I just didn't want to miss the call. I mean, I was that nervous, like, man, I can't miss this call. Like, I mean, you know, and if the cell phone goes out, I need this landline. I had one in my pocket, and, you know, my wife sitting next to me on one side, my grandmother on my other side, my coach was there, my mom was there. I mean, everybody was there. My grandfather was, you know, cooking and keeping everybody company. I'm glad, you know, my grandfather passed, you know, a couple years back. I'm glad he got to experience that, you know, because he gets a lot of credit for me, my accomplishments. But the first round's going and going and going, and my name's not being called. The two teams I thought I was going to go to passed on me, and my agent's calling me, yeah, you know, they chose somebody else. And just like, man, I think I got to the point where I was like, well, maybe this doesn't happen. And so my agent calls me and he says, hey, you know, the Detroit Pistons want to take you. They had like the second or third pick in the second round. But they're basically, they're not promising you anything. You got to come in. You got to earn your spot. You know, you're going to have to make the team, this and that. He said, however, Portland has been calling us and they really like you, but they don't have a draft pick. And they are thinking about trading something for a draft pick if you would agree to come and sign a two-year deal. And so they want to give you a two-year deal for you if you would wait to let them draft you. So my agent's like, I have to tell Detroit not to draft you. So do you want to go to Detroit or do you want to wait for this Portland deal? And it was a no-brainer. Again, Portland was close. They had a great team. They had great guys to learn from, and they're telling me there's a 2-year deal on the table, guaranteed. I've been happy to make a team, so I was like, yeah, please do. And so my agent just told me, he said, you know, they're going to trade and they're going to find something, and we end up finding Atlanta, who had the pick, and they just said, hey, Atlanta's going to draft you, but you're automatically going to be traded to Portland. So don't worry about it. And so I'm just like, okay. And so I think I might have told my wife and maybe my coach, but not anybody else in my family. And just because it was one of those things I just didn't know, you know, I mean, he had already told me that I was going to go in the first round, you know, I mean, so you just never know. But when my name came up and picked by Atlanta and everybody started cheering, and literally my wife and I just broke into tears, because it was just that. It was just that much of a roller coaster, and it was that emotional, and it really was. I mean, it was a dream come true. I mean, it really was. It was like one of those movie moments. I mean, I think if there was an actual movie done, you know, about my life, and that was like kind of that pinnacle, and that was the climax of the movie, I think, I think it would be a pretty good story, considering, you know, the things that we went through and came from. But, that it was a crazy moment, and we just broke into tears, and then I had to kind of let everybody know, no, I'm not going to Atlanta, I'm just going to Portland. And then there was a whole other, you know, stream of emotions, because everybody was excited that I was staying close to home. And so, you know, I mean, and there was, you know, all of the local news was there. My guy, big man Johnson, came out and videoed it from Boise. It was a surreal moment. It was a surreal moment. It was an incredible moment, and it was that much better to be able to share it with so many of the people that I grew up with and the people that I loved and that supported me. So it was great. It was great.
Man, that's so cool. Like, yeah, that's, I can't even imagine that experience, especially in the NBA draft, because in the NFL you get like, you know, 100 rounds to get drafted. No, I'm just kidding, but you get a lot of rounds to get drafted. There's an opportunity for you. There's a lot of players on each team. In the NBA, you got your two rounds. And, I mean, your chances are limited there. And it's kind of cool to hear that, like, you the roller coaster that you went through, that's something that I didn't know. I'm sure a lot of people didn't know that whole experience that you were going through. So just to hear it from you, you can kind of feel the emotion there. Like, I'm, like, sitting here listening to it, and I'm like, dang, dude, that'd be so stressful. I'm, like, I'm feeling stressed out. And that's, what, 20 years ago almost. So, 18, 19 years ago. But, man, that's crazy. So you get to the Blazers. And you're going through preseason and such with them, like camp and whatnot. I want you to explain that experience. Now you're a pro. Now it's not Boise State anymore. Now you're a professional. Talk about your experience that you had with the Blazers.
It was whirlwind. It was whirlwind. It was fast. It was furious, and it was packed. And it was enriching. It was incredible. And so, on draft day, as soon as I got drafted, right after I got drafted, you know, I get a call from head coach, GM, and then I got a call from after I talked to the head coach and GM, I got a call from the assistant coach, who at the time was Tim Gergerich, who's probably the greatest assistant to ever coach in the NBA. And then Bobby Medina, who was the strength and conditioning coach at Portland, who I'm still good friends with to this day. And those two called me, and after the coach and GM called me and welcomed me and said, "Hey, this is how you're doing," those two called me and said, "Hey, are you ready to get to work?" And I was like, "Yes." And I just couldn't. I was just so excited to be there. And he pretty much said, "Well, you pack your bags." He said, "You got 3 days, pack your bags, 3 days, and we're going to start to work." And they said, "Are you okay with that?" And I said, "Yes, I am." And so basically what happened from there is, I enjoyed my time, my family did some stuff, and packed up and headed to Portland. And I got to Portland, and when I got there, I met those guys there and met a couple of other free agent guys that were trying to get on the team and another second round pick from the year before. And we just started working, and it was just the most amazing experience ever. It was just the way, guys worked. We lifted. We worked out twice a day. We lifted twice a day. My first time being in the Portland Trailblazers practice facility, I've never been to a place like this ever in my life. I mean, it was almost like Disneyland. Like, literally, for a basketball player, it was Disneyland. I mean, you go in there, and there's, I don't even know, 8 to 10 baskets, 2 full courts. I mean, all kind of, you got shooting guns. You got going in there, masseuse in there, and you got, training tables and hot tubs and cold tubs. It's everything that you would ever dream or desire from a basketball player in order to, enjoy your experience. I mean, literally, I literally lived there. I mean, there were nights that I actually slept at the facility, slept on the couch. It wasn't like I was, they got ping pong table and pool table and TV. So a lot of times I wasn't just working the whole time, but I'd take breaks and, but it was amazing. And so we got to work right away, lots of workouts, lots of practice. And not shortly after that, we had to go to Summer League. So we had to play in the Summer League and went and played. My first Summer League I played in was in L.A. at the L.A. Summer League at the Pyramid, which, for me was familiar because we played at Long Beach State and played plenty of games there and had plenty of games there. And I played really well. And so that year, the Summer League guys that were kind of on the team already rostered with myself, Bonzi Wells and Kelvin Cato. And then Jermaine O'Neal played with us a little bit. He played here and there. Actually, Greg Anthony actually played in a couple of games with us as well, but not a lot. And so those are the guys that were rostered. We had another guy, Nikita Morganov, who was a Russian guy. He was with us as well. But we played in the LA Summer League, did well. Enjoyed my time there. Straight from the LA Summer League, we went to the Salt Lake Summer League and went to Salt Lake and played, played there, did really well there as well. And we're getting ready to leave Salt Lake. And, it's like, okay, hey, we got this break until, we have to be back at training camp to come back. And so you get done with Summer League, you're getting done, in all, the beginning of August, and we got until, October, until training camp. And my assistant coach said to me, he said, "Hey, you're getting ready to go home." I was like, "Yeah." He's like, "Well, do you want to go, do you want to go to Pete Newell's Big Man Camp in Hawaii?" And I kind of looked at him, and it was, the first two thoughts were, one, Pete Newell's Big Man Camp, why am I going there? And then two, it was like, I want to go home and see my wife and kids. I was like, there's a break. And I looked at him, and he looked at me, and I was like, "Really, Pete Newell Big Man Camp, right?" He was like, "Yeah, but it's just extra work." And when he said that to me, he said, "It's just extra work," it was like, I could not. I was like, I want to play basketball. And so I got to go home for 2 days. He was like, "Okay, you can go home, fly home. We'll get your flight, back from Hawaii to Seattle." So I got to home for 2 days. I went home for 2 days and then flew straight to Hawaii and went to Pete Newell Big Man Camp. And it was all, it was all NBA and college post players, except for three guys, myself, Sean Marion, and Al Harrington. And we were the only three guys that weren't true posts. Now, Al Harrington was a big guy. He was kind of like one of the big, you know, he was one of the first guys that was kind of the big wing, but he wasn't a post. Everybody else was. I mean, you know, Mark Madsen and Todd McCullough, and I mean, it was you know, all post players, and, you know, just all big dudes. And it was an enjoyable time. And I went there, and I was doing both sessions. My assistant coach was just a worker. I mean, he's like, you know, get as much work as you can. And so I actually did the work with the pro guys and the college guys. There was two sessions. And Brad Miller was there. Me and Brad Miller actually hung out a lot. There was a pro session and a college session. I was going to both of them. And I was doing both of them. And in one of them, I turned my ankle. Twisted my ankle, sprained my ankle, went to the trainer, and as I'm seeing the trainer, my assistant coach comes over and checks me out, like, how you doing, blah, 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 and as I'm coming, here comes Pete Newell, and I hadn't actually met him yet, because he didn't run the camp anymore, but he was just kind of around, and I met him, and Pete Newell, this legendary, you know, center from the NBA, looks at my assistant coach and just goes, and I'll never forget this moment, he goes, don't beat a willing horse. And as soon as he said that, my coach kind of looked at him. Coach Gerger looked at him and kind of rolled his eyes and looked at me. And he said, young fella, I can't go against his word. So you're going to have, you know, what are you going to do? He's like, are you going to, you know, you're going to sit, you're going to play? And I was like, no, I got to work out. And so he goes, well, why don't you only do just one session instead of two sessions? And so I only did the first session. I ended up doing the first session. And I'll tell this quick story because it's kind of an interesting story. And he'll remember it. So when the first session was over, the second session, we would go hang out. And I was hanging out myself, Sean Marion, Al Harrington, and Leon Smith. And we were riding mopeds. We went and rented those scooters, those mopeds.
Right.
And we're pulling off. And we get ready to hit this corner. And Al Harrington's first, and then Leon Smith. And then Sean Marion's right in front of me, and I'm last. And when we hit this corner, Sean Marion tries to turn. He's in front of me, and he starts to skid out. I'm kind of laughing at first, like, oh, wow. And then I see him kind of lose control, and he slides, and he skids out, and he skids totally out and slides and falls off the scooter, and his scooter literally just slides from under him, hits a lamp pole, and just obliterates it. I mean, just crushes it, falls into pieces. We had just drove away from the rental. The guy in the rental, he sees it, and he's running and screaming and yelling, what the heck are you doing? So at first I'm kind of giggling, laughing. I'm like, oh crap, this, you know, it's kind of funny. But then I see Sean on the ground, and I'm like, whoa. So then I run over to him. I park my run over. Are you okay? I get up, and this guy is just, I mean, his whole side of his body, leg, and everything is just skinned up. I mean, just like, man, we got to take him. And I'm like, what in the heck are you doing? What's going on? Are you okay? I'm picking him up, and he kind of picks himself up, brushes himself off, and looks at me. He's like, Myrtle, I've never rode one before. And I'm like, what? I'm like, are you serious? You've never driven a scooter. What the heck are you written this for? Like, what are you talking about? And the guy's running over, and the guy's like, man, you owe me $700 or something like that. I mean, it was something ridiculous, you know, something number for scooter. And he goes to an ATM machine, puts his card in, takes the cash out, gives the guy the cash right there, you know. And then, you know, we had to take him and go get him, like, stiff and bossy or whatever. But it was, you know, I'll never forget that moment. It was kind of a crazy deal. You know, I haven't seen him in a while. When I do see him, every once in a while I see him, I'll remind him about it, you know, kind of laugh about it. But, you know, so that was kind of the Pinole experience. And so I thought I was going home from then. And we're getting ready to leave Hawaii. And my coach says to me again, hey, we're going and we're on the way back to Portland. We're going to stop off for a week in L.A. and we're going to go work out some of our guys. Greg Anthony was staying there at the moment. Jermaine O'Neal, and then Stacey Ogden was also there. So I didn't get to go home. I went straight to L.A. and I worked out with those guys, and then I played in a couple of pro-am games. They had this pro-am league down there called the Real Run, which at that time was actually better than the Drew League. But the Drew League was just starting to go on, and so I kind of played in both of them. And we would play in those. We would work out in the mornings. We would go to UCLA and do UCLA's open gym, which was an experience that I will treasure forever. The fact that I got to actually go and play against Magic Johnson, see Magic Johnson playing at an open gym, at UCLA open gym, obviously, was a legend. You know, it was crazy. Some other guys, Baron Davis was there, obviously, but he was still, you know, he was still playing. So that was cool, but it was just taking my, it was a whole another, we went down there for a week. And then after we went there, I finally got a chance. We were like, okay, hey, you get a chance. We got, you know, you can maybe go home. And I think I went home for one day. And after that one day, I had to be back in Portland because we had to practice for, we had a mini camp in Vegas. So we went to, I'm sorry, we didn't do that. It was different. Sorry. We went back to Portland. We had a mini camp in Portland, a mini camp to prepare for training camp. It was crazy. Yeah. And so went to training camp, got to training camp. So I basically had 3 days. I had 3 days, at home during the whole summer after I was drafted. It was a whirlwind, but it was, I wouldn't change it for anything. And, you know, that kind of led me up to training camp. And when we got to training camp, a lot of stuff had changed. A lot of guys that we thought were going to be on the team that got traded, they had to do like a 6 or 7 player trade. Stacey Ogden was one of the guys that got traded, which was sad for me because I had got to know him really well. He had kind of taken me under his wing, and he was absolutely phenomenal, just a pro's pro and just the greatest guy, probably one of the greatest guys I've ever met. Got traded to Portland for Scottie Pippen. And when I got to Portland, the number I chose, 20 was retired, so I didn't get to have that. 11 was taken by Detlef Schrempf. Didn't get to get that one. I don't even remember what my next choice was. I think I had one other choice and somebody else had it. I chose 33. I had the number. I was 33 for the first, 2 days or 3 days of training camp. And then Scottie Pippen trade comes and he shows up. And when he showed up the next day on my locker, no longer 33, it was 4. And it wasn't, there wasn't any conversation. There wasn't like, hey, can I, you hear these stories about these guys, you know, trading guys' numbers or paying or taking them to dinner or whatever. And I didn't think about it when he traded, but when I got there, I thought about it. I'm like, man, nobody even asked me. You know, I was like, nope, it's here's your number. You know, you got a new number. And so, Scottie Pippen showed up, and I was in awe a little bit. I hadn't at that point been in awe of anybody. I mean, I definitely looked up to Steve Smith and watched him a lot when I was young and loved him. But Scottie Pippen was just a little bit different. I mean, there was like a little bit of a, like, I looked like, oh, like I was like, wow, this is Scottie Pippen. That was a huge moment for me. And my first day of training camp, my first practice, I was on the second team. Scottie Pippen was guarding me, and I shot faked and got Scottie on a pump fake and hit a jump shot. And that was absolutely, I don't know if I remember anything else that whole day of training camp, or maybe training camp, I mean, that whole day other than that. As soon as I got done with practice, I called Ed Boyce, called my coach and said, Coach, I got Scottie Pippen today. I mean, it was that type of moment. It was that type of moment. After that, I had a really good camp. I mean, I had a really, really good camp. I had a really good training camp, everything. I mean, I played well. I think my first ever professional game, exhibition game, was against the Sonics. I came in late in the game. The game was close. I think I had like 14 points and like 5 assists in like, 20 minutes, less than 20 minutes. You know, all the news reporters were, I was the first person they went to, and people were, all my teammates were like, wow. So I did really well. I mean, I had a great time, learned a lot. Steve Smith took me under his wing, basically showed me the ropes of how to be a pro, how to work, do that stuff. To this day, I'll never forget him. Detlef Schrempf, I had knew him already before from being in, he was in the Seattle area when I grew up. I definitely knew, the type of work ethic he had. Damon Stoudemire was great to me. Brian Grant was phenomenal to me. He was injured a lot when I was there. But he was huge. All those guys, Rashid was the most generous human being I've ever been around in my life. He just didn't get along with refs too well, but everybody else was great too. Those guys, Bonzi Wells, formed a bond with him. I mean, those guys were just phenomenal. I had a great time. And then, you know, last day of training camp, you know, I thought I was good. You know, I thought I was good. I thought I was going to be on, I thought I was going to be there for at least 2 years and learn from those guys and be there, you know, for the contract I had. I was ready to go. It was all great. Last day of training camp, you know, they kind of brought me in and just, you know, they said, hey, you know, we made that trade for Scotty and we traded those guys away. You know, we always planned to have you here as that guy to back up Scotty and Steve Smith and, you know, kind of be that next guy and learn from them. But Stacey Augmon had got waived by the Houston Rockets after they traded him, and Portland got first right to the season, and they brought him back, and they just kind of put it out there and said, hey, we think you have a bright future. You'll be on a team. They said, but you know, we're trying to win a championship, and Stacey Augmon is one of the premier defenders in the NBA, winning defenders in the NBA. And we feel that, you know, we need him to, you know, to guard Kobe Bryant. We need him to guard, you know, whoever in order for us to win a championship. And that was the spot that we had slotted for him. I mean, it was that cut and dry. And, you know, I mean, obviously I was disappointed. I mean, I was really disappointed. I mean, I was heartbroken because, you know, I mean, I just, you know, I knew what I was going to do. But, you know, I didn't waste any time. I didn't waste any time. You know, I called my wife and said, hey, we got to pack up. We got to get home. We got to get to work. I mean, I got to get to work and I got to be ready for whatever's next. And, you know, Arvydas Sabonis was great. You know, he offered me a job with the team that he owned for a boatload of money, going to Lithuania and playing for a team that he owned. You know, and so, you know, everything about it was really, really great. I mean, that was a bittersweet moment because it was heartbreaking. But you know, it definitely shaped me. I mean, it definitely shaped me and shaped me for the rest of my career, the rest of my life.
Man, that's such a cool experience to hear the behind the scenes story of it all. I mean, obviously that was like a 15-minute blurb of like a couple of months, you know what I mean? Like there's a lot going on in that couple months, and it's insane to hear it from you what was going on. And bless your wife's heart, man, because if I'm not mistaken, you guys, I think your oldest boy was really, really little. So you had that experience there. Obviously it shaped you. Your pro career did not end when you got let go. At the end of training camp, you had a good run in the pros, and a lot of it was overseas. You had a couple years here as well with the Idaho Stampede, a couple stints with the Stampede, if I'm not mistaken. I think it was three, and one of them you actually won the D-League championship, I think. Man, in your time overseas, though, this is one thing, because I had a podcast episode I did talking about the G League, which used to be the D League, versus Euro ball and overseas basketball, and why certain players decide to go over there rather than stay here and try to make it in the G League. There's, you know, pros and cons, salaries, money, this and that. But you went overseas and had a really successful career. What was your favorite experience playing over there, and how did it elevate your game for when you came back and even played for the Stampede?
Well, I think my favorite experience of being overseas was my middle son Ryzen. He actually called him Biggie. Nobody even he. I don't even know if he knows his first name. If he doesn't, doesn't like it. He's a junior. He's a junior at Bora High. But he was born in France. So he was born in France, in Dijon, France, my first year playing European. I played the 2 years in the NBA and CBA. And then that third year in Europe, I was in the CBA, and the CBA went bankrupt. And so we had no jobs, and so I got a job in France, and he was born over there. So that was absolutely my favorite experience over there was obviously his birth and you know, raising him over there and all that. So it was incredible. It was incredible. But my European experience absolutely changed my life. I mean, I think I know for a fact going to Boise, that saved my life. It definitely being there helped me to have an environment to mature. I matured. I got rid of, you know, all of the toxic, you know, things I was doing, you know, in my life up to that point, and just got really simplified my life and what I wanted to do. And obviously, it was basketball and my family and career, just built a family. But Europe actually changed my life. dramatically, because it gave me, it helped me with tolerance, and it helped me to, you know, learn and experience other cultures and have more understanding and better understanding of people. Up to that point, I was a little bit, you know, closed-minded, I would say, you know, it's, you know, just the way we are. It's like, you know, I mean, I enjoy people, and I think I was open and friendly to everyone, but, you know, I think I found it was time not to be judgmental about, you know, if people did things a certain way. And then when you go to Europe, everything is different. Right. Even, you know, I mean, just personal space is different. And having to adjust to having, you know, somebody stand and breathe on your neck in the supermarket line and have to get used to that, you know, every day, you know, instead of turning around and giving them the evil eye, like, why are you so close to me? You know, help me to again, be understanding and tolerant of, you know, all people and what people are going through, what people believe, and start to realize that just because people are different doesn't mean they're wrong. It doesn't mean it's wrong. And, you know, Europe helped me to change that. And, you know, I got to be, you know, I lived in France with the French, you know, lived in Melilla, Spain 1 year, which is actually on the northern tip of Africa, Morocco, and spent a lot of time with in the Islam community. Lived in Spain, you know, in the Catholic community. You know, with Turkey, and in Turkey, obviously, you know, they're a big Islamic state. Played in South Korea, and learned about that culture. And so, I just think it was such a cultural experience for me that it changed, you know, it changed my outlook on life. And so it was, that's the best part about it.
That's so rad. It's so cool to hear that, because a lot of people don't hear the whole experience. Most people just look at the big players that go overseas, they're playing over there just because the money's decent, you know, and they don't really hear the cultural side of it. So that's awesome. The last thing I'll ask you about your pro career, Berto, what was your greatest accomplishment as a professional?
As a professional?
Yeah, as a professional basketball player.
As a professional basketball player, my biggest accomplishment, I probably have to say three things. One, being drafted. Two, winning the D-League championship. And then three, getting my jersey retired by the Stampede. Those are probably the top three accomplishments, I think.
And that jersey retirement was number 11, which you told us earlier you switched to number 11 for Jerry Washington. So that must be really special, the fact that you got that number 11 retired.
Yeah, it is. And I just, you know, I don't, you know, it's another one of those moments that, you know, you feel proud that you were able, that I'm hopefully that people see that number and don't just associate it with me, but associate it with Jerry as well. And so it does. I mean, I feel proud that I was able to hopefully, you know, continue to keep, you know, to let people keep him on the top of his head. And, you know, I mean, the people out there that, you know, are listening, there are people that listen that remember G-Dub, remember Jerry. You know, I mean, he's still in the same state he is. He's living with his parents in L.A. And, you know, he's still alive. I mean, he's still alive and breathing and kicking and recognizing him. He's not functioning like he was before. But you know, hopefully people, when they go, you know, to the arena. I haven't been to the arena in 2 years, so I don't know if it's still hanging up there as well. I know they were talking about taking it down. I'm hoping it's still there, but if they do take it down, hopefully I'll get it.
Right.
You know, I would love to be able to have it. But, you know, just to keep him and his family, you know, in mind and remember him, remember the great thing that he did for the Boise community, because he was huge. He was huge.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. Now, to wrap up, I want to actually talk about how you're making another stamp, another impact in the Treasure Valley. Your pro career may be over, but you're still making an impact with the youth. Now, a couple of years back, well, it's not been a couple, it's been about 8 years ago, I returned from Brazil serving a mission for my church, and I got back from Brazil after being gone for 2 years, and I was coaching for the Special Olympics. I did 2 years of that just over there, and one of the referees was a volunteer referee, and this, I just remember talking to her, she was telling me, she's like, yeah, you'll want to keep an eye on this guy right here. And there's like three basketball players, and they were in the eighth grade, if I'm not mistaken, seventh or eighth grade, going into ninth grade. And she's like, these guys, they play for Hoop Dreams. And I'm like, what the heck is Hoop Dreams? And she's like, it's like a club team, and they're really good. They play against some really good, like really good talent regionally, and they have been competing, blah, 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 blah. Well, anyways, I see them shooting around, and one of the kids takes a Euro step. And I'm like, what eighth grader can do a Euro step? Like, who? That's not even a thing. You know what I mean? Like, that wasn't even thought of, like, in high school when I was playing for Meridian. So it was like, we didn't learn Euro steps in high school. These kids are doing it in the eighth grade. And then I started looking into it. I'm like, what is Hoop Dreams? And that's when your name came up. I want you to talk about how you're bringing knowledge to help the youth. Like, you're using your knowledge, your game, everything you experienced throughout your career, and now you're showing other people how to do it. What is Hoop Dreams, and can you explain how it started and what you got planned for it?
Well, my second year out professionally, the summers, in the summertime, I would always come back to Boise State and work out with my coach, Ed Boyce, because he was kind of my workout guy. So I came back in the summer, and he and I were talking, and we just were kind of looking around, and it was just like, you know, we there were some kids. His kid was EJ Boyce, who's actually playing at St. Martin's College now, who probably was one of those eighth graders that you saw.
Right.
He was on that team. He was phenomenal. He was in the third grade at that point. My son Rylan was just getting ready to I think EJ was second grader. EJ was a second grader, and Rylan was kindergarten. And so we were talking about, you know, our kids doing some camps and stuff. And it was like, man, I've been and looked around, and there's just the camps, they're just not high quality camps. And he said, you know, what do you think about it? And so he and I, we got together and said, let's do a summer camp. Let's do a summer camp for the kids in Boise. Just, you know, like you said, we just wanted to share our knowledge. I mean, we just wanted to be able to share what we had to help the kids, you know, in the community get, you know, some basketball, you know, at a level that, you know, we thought would help the culture, help the basketball culture. And so we were getting ready to start this camp. We met a guy by the name of Ben Reed, who at the time ran AAU and worked for the YMCA. We met him, and we brought him on to help us with the admin part of the camp. And we formed Hoop Dreams basketball camp, Roberto Bergeson's Hoop Dreams camp. And we did those for a couple of years in the summer, and every time we get to the camp, we would have people coming to us, and they would ask us, hey, can we do more? Can you do more? We want to do more. We want to do more. We want to do more. So we went from doing just one summer camp. When I would go overseas, Ed and Ben would run like a Christmas to holiday camp, and I would be gone, and, you know, we'd talk about what we need to do, and then we would do like a spring break camp. And in those camps, formed into, can we do more? And then so we started, it kind of just grew to we would have more kids. We'd have waiting lists. I mean, we'd have waiting lists for our camps, and we couldn't get to all the kids. And so we just started getting more people involved, and then Chandler Williams came involved, and Cassidy Blaine, and more people that were former Broncos. And we started doing these, what we call them academies. And they were first called, so they were called Premier Academies. And we did them for like, we would do them for like month long stretches. They would get like 2 days a week for like a whole month. Actually, I think we even did 2 month stretches. And then after that, again, people started more and more. And then at that point, there was people that said, hey, would you guys want to coach us? And this whole time I'm in Europe. And so I'm hearing all this stuff, you know, I'm in Europe and I come back in the summers and work, and Ed and Ben would be working at home. And so then Ed Boyce, created a team, and it was his son, and then Isaiah Wright, who's at San Diego now, and Sam Simpson, who's at Seattle Pacific. Those three guys, and then there was a couple of other guys joined later. Braden Shaw, who's at BYU, he played on that team a little bit. They formed a team, and they made a team, and we called it Hoop Dreams. And then from then on, then it just started to trickle. There was other people that wanted to come under our umbrella and be coached by us and have us help learn them. Cassidy Blaine started a girls team. There's another guy named Todd Lukey who came in. He had a couple of boys and some girls. And all of a sudden, it just blew up. I mean, it just blew up, and we just started having this team come in, and people wanted us to, you know, help them coach, and we started having kids. And so we sat down and said, hey, we got to figure out what some kind of structure for this. I mean, we had no structure for it at all. We just were kind of just, you know, people were asking for stuff. And so, you know, we were giving it to them. So we sat down and we talked, and we just said, hey, what do we want to do with this, and what this is about. And our whole goal and our whole plan, you know, I mean, when you start to coach and you start to actually, like, give your information out, you realize and you recognize really quickly, that the coaching, the coaching and the tutelage is not even 50% of the development. The biggest part of development is actually the individuals and how they're going to take it. And the first thing, in developing, players or kids or anybody is to get people that are similar, so real and competitive against each other. And so we thought of this and said, hey, the best thing that we can do for the culture, the basketball culture in Boise, is try to get the kids that want it the most, the kids that really, really want and desire to be basketball players, and that they just want to be committed, get them, and they're going to compete against each other. And if they compete against each other, that's more than 50% of the development of what we're doing. The rest of it, we can help them. We can teach them to do these things and help them, but it's not going to go anywhere if the kids don't really want it. And so that was our whole goal, was to try to get the best kids or the most competitive kids or the kids that desire the most together and actually let steel sharpen steel. And, so that was kind of our focus. We just wanted to build the basketball culture, and we wanted to try to do the best we could to enable some kids to have an opportunity to have a future after high school to prolong their life and prolong their experiences. And I was hoping that some kids could have experiences like I had coming to Boise and changing my life, or playing professionally, or meeting these people in relationships, but through basketball. And we knew the only way they could do it is they were really, really good. And at that point, there just wasn't a whole lot of kids. I mean, I think on average, I think it was like the average at that time when we started, the average per year of boys, anyways, that were going on to playing college basketball, to playing Division I basketball, was like a half. It was like 0.5. It wasn't even one full player. And then I think, by the time we got to 2013, that had changed to like 1.5. and then the 2014 class, which was our first class that we started with, that was the class with Isaiah Wright, EJ Boyce. There were 4 players on that team that played Division I basketball from one team. I mean, it was unheard of. Considering on average there was 1.5 players from the whole state. And so that's kind of the start of Hoop Dreams and how it started and how it went. And it's just grown and grown and grown. And not only has it grown, in Hoop Dreams, but it's grown around the community. Now, we were the only, whatever you want to call it, travel team or club basketball. Now there's 8 of them probably. I don't know. They might not be 8. That might be a hyperbole, but there's at least 6 or 7. And then a bunch of other athletes. Everybody's doing it. Everybody's trying to do it. Everybody's doing it. It's cool to see that the culture of Boise the basketball in Boise has gone from where kids couldn't find a place to play or coaches to coach or whatever, to now there's basketball going on all the time, all year round. That has been a plus, but, just like everything in life, when you have any type of evolution and any advancement or any growth, there's also recession. And so it's kind of actually the club stuff, it kind of actually watered some things down a little bit too, because now you've got instead of having all those good players together learning all in one place and sharpening each other, you've kind of got factions here and there and here and there. And so it's kind of been a little bit of it's got to a little bit of a plateau a little bit. And so at this point, we're brainstorming. We're brainstorming ways of kind of continuing to raise that culture and let that culture continue to grow. Our 2016 and 17 class, we had our girls. The girls is phenomenal. The girls is just killing it. I mean, we've had so many Division I girls right now. Tori Williams is the best freshman in the Pac-12, and she's killing it. Utah, Destiny. Destiny Slocum was the freshman player of the year last year. She's sitting out at Oregon State this year. Mandy Simpson is, has started some games at Oklahoma. She got a 13-rebound game as a freshman. Lauren Brockie is playing at Colorado State. It's just been huge. And our boys, our 2016 and 17 class, we had 6 kids out of there that are Division I. DeAndre Jones just had a triple-double the other day, the first player ever in the first player since Scottie Pippen, which is crazy, right? Full circle, at Central Arkansas to have a triple-double in a game. So that stuff has been great. And this year, the 2018 class, I think there's only one kid from the area that has a Division I scholarship. And then 2019, hopefully that'll kind of go a little bit more. So it's starting to plateau out a little bit. We're trying to raise that level again. But that's our whole goal. Our whole goal is to try to give kids opportunities and experiences similar to what we have had in life that has helped us to just, you know, to be where we are today and hopefully be able to say that, you know, we're good people. And it's all because, you know, basketball kind of gave us that platform to do it and gave us the tools to do it. So,
for sure, man. It's so awesome to see how you made an impact as a player, a young, you know, 20 in your early 20s here in Boise. You know, flash forward 20 years later or so, and you're still doing it and helping the young kids out. And that Hoop Dreams squad you were referring to, like, with EJ and Isaiah, all them, like, you had even like the guys like John Shirley, like the guys that, man, like, there's a lot of kids that grew up. I watched them through high school, and just seeing them now, I'm like, my goodness, dude. And it's cool because you had a direct impact on that. And like you said, it's got to be the kids that want it. So, like, steel sharpens steel, essentially. Like, you got the good coaching, but they've got to have the desire. It's cool to see when you can mix both of them and see the success that you've seen with those guys. And obviously, I mean, your boys playing over at BYU, like, you've got, like, I'm just telling you, man, you're making a major impact, and it's cool to watch that. You're just, the Treasure Valley should be grateful for Roberto Bergeson in more ways than one. So I appreciate you joining the show with me today, Berto. And for all my listeners, I hope you enjoyed this and learned something from it. And we'll talk to you guys next week. Thank you so much for listening to this episode. Before you leave, please head on over to iTunes and leave me a review. I would greatly appreciate it because it helps me out a ton. Thanks, guys. Appreciate the support.